Good morning. Good morning and welcome to Garrison Road Church this morning. We're so excited this morning to celebrate Palm Sunday with you guys. For those of you in person, it's lovely to see all of your smiling faces. For those of you online, we'd love to know that you're here and say good morning to you. So if you say good morning to us, we'll know you're here and say a nice good morning to you guys. So we're super excited for the message this morning. I know Jeff's got a great one planned, so with that said, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this community and this family. We thank you for new members, and we thank you for new people joining us. We thank you for those who have been here for decades and been here for years. Lord, we know that no matter how long we've been in your family, we are all a part of your family. We thank you for the brothers and sisters in Christ that we have come to know and come to get to know. And we thank you for the connections that we have with them and that they can help us grow. They can help us grow as Christians and grow into the people that you have set us to be. Lord, we thank you for your glory and your mercy and your blessings. And we thank you that we have the opportunity this morning to worship you. We pray a blessing upon the service this morning, and we pray that anyone that hears the message hears what you have for them. We pray that it applies to their life and it applies to their experiences, and that they can hear and get the most out of your word for them this morning. We pray all this in your holy name. Amen.
It's all-consuming, isn't it? The ocean takes up most of our planet. Fathom, if you will, just the enormity of it. It's raw, unhinged, effortless energy. It's the type of power, if we're not careful, that can sweep us away. It's kind of like money, isn't it? For success, for relationships, control, comfort, security. Because you see, in each one of our little worlds, we have this force. And this powerful force can overtake us. And if it does that, we basically crown it king of our lives. Yes, we give it power. Give you another visual. First century Jerusalem, it's Passover, and a man rides into town, not on a horse, but on a donkey, and the crowd goes nuts. He doesn't look like a king, but the crowd has already proclaimed him to be just that. They are waving palm branches, they're throwing down their cloaks, because they had already decided and believed that he was the one foretold by scriptures, that he was the Messiah. But the throne of power that was placed upon Jesus that day was not the throne that he came to sit upon. You see, nobody understood on the road to Jerusalem the suffering that he would endure for their sake and for ours as well. He would be crowned, but with thorns. But don't you understand that Jesus is the King? He is the King that gives sight to the blind. He is the King that walks on water. He is the King that says, even if you do not worship me, the rocks will cry out and praise my name. Oh yes, he is the King. And now that you've caught a glimpse of the enormity of his power, you must decide and deliberate if Jesus will be King of your life. And as for me, Jesus is my King!
Good morning. Our scripture reading today is from Matthew 21:1-10. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" Please stand if you can to worship together.
Now with you. Good morning. One of the privileges I have is welcoming new people into membership. So I'm going to ask John Paul, Don, Lynn, and Judy to come on up to the front. I gave John Paul and Don about 15 minutes notice, but it will be easy. It's just a short quiz. If you go through that door, that'll be easier. Just go through that door, come out over here. All right, so we get to welcome them into membership this morning. I'm excited to be able to do that. If you are interested in membership, it is not hard. We have a Get to Know Garrison session that we have after church every couple months. And so the next one is coming up April 7th It's about 45 minutes. We go through who we are, where we have been, and where we're going. And so you attend that, and then we talk a little bit about membership, and then we welcome you into membership. And I'm excited to do that. I'm excited to welcome the four of you into membership today. It's a bit bittersweet, I know, for you. The four of them were previously at the Well, and I have been through a similar situation, so I know the grieving and the hurt that comes with saying goodbye to a previous church. And I'm trying to contain my excitement that you're here in the midst of your grieving. We are so excited that you are here, and it is a blessing to us, and we are honored that you are joining us in membership. And so after the service, if you could congratulate them and welcome them, that'd be wonderful. Let me pray for you this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your church. We thank you for the community of faith. Lord, we thank you for the honor and the privilege of welcoming Jean-Paul, Don, Lynn, and Judy into membership. Lord, we thank you for their desire to serve you, to identify and be known as your children, to walk in your steps. Lord, we thank you for their desire to be part of this church and be in membership here. Lord, we ask that you would bless each one of them, that you would honor their commitment, that you would bless them and watch over them. Lord, that you would give them an incredible sense of your love for them. And Lord, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I was talking with Jacqueline last week, and we realized that over the last number of years, because of COVID and everything, we haven't done any baby dedications or child dedications, and even welcoming people into membership. And Matt and Diane are about to be empty nesters. No. So we were talking about child dedication and baby dedication. At our church, we don't do child baptism. We do adult baptism as a profession of faith. And but if you have children and have babies, what we do is we have a moment in the service where we pray for that child. And you commit, you dedicate them to the Lord, and you commit to raise them in the Lord. And so if you have a child under the age of 18, because it doesn't have to be someone who's a newborn baby, but if you have anyone and you have never dedicated them to God and committed to raise them in the love of Jesus, come speak to me, and we would love to, in April, do a child dedication, or two, or three, or four. Also, baptism. If you have been a Christian longer than 2 minutes, that's your requirement, and you haven't been baptized, please come see me after the service. We are going to have the opportunity to be baptized next week on Easter Sunday. And so if you are interested in being baptized, please come see me. Time is running out. Now, you don't have to get baptized now. You could get baptized later. But again, if it's been more than 2 minutes, you're qualified. All right. Well, there you go.
If we would have planned this better, we could have pulled out the old directory photos of Lynn and Judy. They were attenders back in the 80s, and we used to have a church directory that had the pictures of all the attendees, and Lynn and Judy and Dale and his brother and Christy, they are all in the picture. I should have put that up from the beginning, but it's great to welcome you guys back and to welcome Jean-Paul and Don as well. So I love to when this happens. So. Some announcements we want to share with you. Good Friday is coming up this Friday, so 10 a.m. is the Good Friday service, and then we will have the Easter Sunday service at 10 a.m. on Sunday. So please invite a friend out. Invite somebody out to experience one of the joyous occasions. One of the most joyous occasions in the church calendar is Easter. So please, Good Friday at 10 a.m. and then Easter Sunday at 10 a.m. as well. Jeff mentioned the Get to Know Garrison Road Church. That's April 7th after the service. Again, about 45 minutes just to learn more about Garrison Road Church. Our men's group is growing strong. Had about 16 guys out on this past Thursday. None of the lessons or the times relate to one another. So if you haven't been or if you missed the previous week, please come on out Thursday night. We'd love to have you out there. We do have coffee. We do have snacks. The guys make fun of me because I'm the one making the coffee. But, you know, nobody's complained about the coffee yet. So we'll enjoy that. But come on out Thursday nights, 7 a.m. This week, we're going to learn about the discipline of ministry. So it's a great time to come out. So please come on out for the Thursday night men's group. The business meeting. The business meeting we did have planned for March 24th. Unfortunately, we'll have to postpone that. We haven't gotten our financials back from our accountant. So when we do, we'll reschedule that. We're expecting it sometime in April. All right. So with that, let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this church family. We thank you for this family of believers that we can come together and we can worship you. Lord, this is a special Sunday, the Palm Sunday. Lord, we thank you for what this means to us. We know that Christmas, we celebrate the birth of your son, and we know that we celebrate all the good things that come with that. But we know that it led up to his death and ultimately his resurrection. Help us to celebrate that as well in this Easter season. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that we're able to come together and we're able to worship you. Help us to never to take that for granted. Help us to recognize that there are areas in the world where this is not allowed. But we have the freedom and we have the ability and we do this together. Help us to share that with our friends and our family. Help us to share that with our friends and family that don't know you. Help us to be bold in our faith. Help us to invite others out. Help us to share the love, to share the gift that you have given us in the love and the forgiveness of our sins through Jesus' death, through Jesus's death and resurrection. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that we can be there for one another. We know that there are many people in our church that are hurting. And Lord, we pray continually for these difficulties. And Lord, we just want to lift up before you, and we continue to lift up before you Barry Spray. We ask that you be with Barry as he continues to heal at home. And Lord, we just ask that you bring him back to us. And Lord, we pray a prayer of praise for the return of Jill Ransom. And we thank you, Lord, for being with her and for blessing her and for being with Peter as well. We thank you, Lord, for the doctors and the nurses that were treating her. And we just thank you that she is back here with us. We continue to lift up Bruce Thompson as well. We know that Bruce is at home and is recovering, and we thank you, Lord, for that. We thank you for the care that he received in Port Colborne, and we just ask you, Lord, just to be with Sharon as he continues to heal at home. And when he's feeling ready, Lord, when his strength is back, we welcome him back here. We know, Lord, that you will be with him and you will be with Sharon as he continues to heal. We continue to lift up before you, Lord, Gail Edmund as well. We know that Gail is having difficulty with her back pain, and we ask you, Lord, just to be with her and Joe as well. Help her to deal with the pain and help her to get some relief from that. Lord, we pray for Christine Sullivan as well. We know that Christine is going through her cancer treatments, and we know that you will be with her through those treatments. Lord, this strikes home personally for me. I pray a prayer of praise for what you've done in my sister-in-law, Denise. We know that Denise has just finished her last treatment and has gotten a good report from the doctors. And we thank you, Lord, for the prayers of this church for Denise. Lord, we know that Denise wants to be back here with us, among us, and we know that her smiling face will be welcomed. We know that she lights up a room when she comes in, and her kind heart is recognized by almost everyone she meets. And I just thank you, Lord, for her and what she means to our family. And we just thank you, Lord, for the watchful care that you've given her. I pray for those that are continuing to go through ongoing difficulties. We lift up before you Allie Pohl. We pray for Pam and for Mia. We pray for Emily, for Dave and Kathy Bellefontaine, as well as Carrie and Stephanie and Tammy and Ted as well, Lord. We know that this list we pray for every week, but we know it's not exhaustive. We know that there are people who are hurting, that the difficulties we don't know about. But we have the blessed assurance that you know about these difficulties, Lord. We know that you will be there for us. But help us to bring our difficulties known to the rest of the congregation. Help us to be bold and to recognize that we can't do this walk alone, that we need brothers and sisters in Christ. Help us to recognize that some may have gone through similar difficulties and can be an inspiration to us. I thank you, Heavenly Father, for the men's group that you've started. I thank you for the willingness to share that these guys have shown, that we're experiencing life together and that we can be there for one another. I thank you, Lord, for the resources and the blessings that you've given this church that we're able to do events like this. I thank you for the women's group and for the small group that get together after church. And I pray for the youth ministry, whether it's the Sunday school classes or the youth that meet midweek. Lord, we know that your presence is felt through all these events. Help to use these events to draw us closer to you. Help us to use these events to draw others that don't know you closer to you. Help us to walk in the steps of Jesus, and help us to help others to walk in the steps of Jesus as well. Lord, I just pray your blessing upon the rest of the service. I ask you to be with Pastor Jeff and to bless our time together as we continue to worship and to praise your name. Help us to get ready for the Easter season. Help us to recognize its significance, and help us to recognize that this is a great opportunity to share your love. We ask this all in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. So we're going to sing a couple more worship songs, so please, if you're able, stand with us as we sing the Lord's Prayer.
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done. On earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive the ones who sinned against us. Deliver us from the evil one. Let your kingdom come.
If you are 10 or under, this is your moment. Head on out the back. We got a great time planned for you. All right. Thank you, Rose, for reading scripture this morning. She was a little nervous beforehand. I was teasing her, switching around stuff, and it's always fun to tease someone when they're really stressed. Appreciate Rose reading this morning. I loved the way the scripture passage ended. I mean, it ends with this question, right? Who is this? If we look back at the scripture passage in Matthew 21, verse 7, they brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" They want to know, what's all the excitement about? What's this parade? Who's this person coming in? Why are people shouting and celebrating? And it's such an important question. Who is this? I think over the years, I know my understanding of who Jesus is has changed. I think for all of us, it changes. I think of as a little child going to Sunday school and learning who Jesus is. And getting different pictures, different ideas of who Jesus is and what he's like. I think of the idea of who Jesus is before being a Christian and after being a Christian. The more we know Jesus, the more we follow in his steps, walking in his steps, the more we learn about who he is. This week I was reading through list of 50 different names and titles of Jesus. 50 different names and titles. It was amazing to read through them all and look at the scripture passages. It's an important question. Who is this? Who is Jesus? The answer to that question can change your life. Can change your life today and tomorrow and the years to come. It can change your life for all of eternity. Who is Jesus is the question we'll be looking at today. Now, to start that, we are going to get your brains going, do a little interactive bit. We are going to get you to talk to the person next to you. Where you sit is important. And so for the next 2 minutes, I want you to talk to someone around you and answer the question, who is Jesus? All right. Break into groups, talk with each other. Who is Jesus? All right, you've had a couple minutes to talk. Who is Jesus? What are some of the answers you came up with? This is where you have to call it. Yes. Yeah. The King. Yeah. And I heard Savior over here. Yeah. Who else? Any other answers? Messiah. Sorry, what was it? Messiah? Shepherd. Son of God? Shepherd? God? Living Word? All right. The guy who told Zacchaeus to go under the tree, yeah. All right, I got a list of 50. We're about 20% of the way there. All right. Right? Bread of life. Yeah. It's amazing when you read through Scripture and you see all the different titles for Christ. You start to see the breadth of who he is, the depth of who he is, the majesty of who he is. It's interesting, if you were to go out, if we went down to Walmart and we were to talk to people in Walmart and ask them who is Jesus, you're going to get a lot of different responses. One of the responses you would get would be a negative one. You ask people in our society who is Jesus, there are those that would say, well, he was a fraud, or he was crazy, a liar, or a lunatic. This we encounter as we read through Scripture. Early on in his ministry, he's preaching in his hometown, and in Mark chapter 6, verse 3, the crowd gets a little incensed by Jesus, and they say, isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. In John chapter 12, the recording Palm Sunday in John in chapter 12. At the end of it, the Pharisees, they look at each other and they say, look, the whole world has gone after him. And they're incensed. So the Pharisees in Jesus' day saw Jesus as a problem, as someone who is leading people astray. Today, a lot of the new atheists or people writing atheist books describe Jesus as a problem. A second view you would encounter in Walmart would be a neutral view. You ask them, who is this? Who is Jesus? And they would say, I don't know. And I don't care. Right? That would be the honest answer. I don't know and I don't care. He's not relevant. He doesn't change my life. I'm not interested. Let me do my shopping and stop talking to me. Right? That would be the response. Another group would say Jesus is a good moral teacher. And that's a popular view. Jesus is a good moral teacher. He was a man, but he's a good teacher. That would be actually the view that would be shared by most people who are Buddhist. They would see Jesus as one of the enlightened ones, but he's one of many. Others would say Jesus is a prophet. In fact, the crowds said that. Today's scripture reading, we ended at verse 10, but if you read verse 11, the crowds answer the question, who is this? When they say, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. So are those who saw him as a prophet. You might be surprised to know this is one of the major views around the globe today. In Islam, Jesus is seen as not God, but as a prophet of God. So in the Muslim faith, they would say Jesus is a prophet, due honor. And so there are people that would see him as a prophet. The next view would be that Jesus is a God. Not the God, but a God. I encountered this years ago. Our church in Mississauga was a church plant, and we were doing door-to-door. I was in my late teens, and I went along doing door-to-door. That was an interesting experience. That was in the 80s. And one of the things we found when we went door-to-door is we were in an area with a large Hindu population. And so as you would go door to door and you would tell them that Jesus is God, they would say, that's wonderful. You would say, would you like to accept him as God? And they say, absolutely. It was really easy. Because in Hinduism, there are many gods. And so if there's a new God, they would add him in. It was when you said Jesus is the way, the truth, the life, singular, you ran into problems. But amongst Hinduism, those that practice Hinduism, there is the understanding that Jesus is a God, not the God. Well, and the final view would be that Jesus is God. Jesus is our Savior. We see that throughout Scripture in Luke chapter 2, verse 11. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. 1 John 4, verse 14, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. How many people know Jesus as Savior? Right? We know Jesus as Savior. And it's wonderful. It's a wonderful thing to know Jesus as Savior, to have forgiveness, to know that we have forgiveness of sins, that we have eternal life. We have this incredible gift, this gift that's talked about in Romans chapter 6, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Salvation through Jesus, our Savior. The good news, the hope of Easter. Reading through the Gospels, an interesting question comes up. As you read through the Gospels, this question comes up, and the question is, What was the good news that Jesus and his disciples preached? What was the good news that Jesus and his disciples preached? Our immediate answer would be, well, it would be the good news of salvation. It'd be that Jesus died for us and rose again. But there's a problem. There's a problem because at the beginning of the Gospels, Jesus hasn't told people about Easter yet. His disciples don't know about Easter yet. Like we read in Matthew 4, verse 23, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness among the people. Or in Mark chapter 1, verses 14 and 15, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. Now, both those passages are early in Jesus' ministry. Jesus isn't talking about the cross at this point. He hasn't told his disciples about it, right? So what is the good news that Jesus is sharing if he's not talking about salvation and the cross and Easter? What is the good news? The good news is hinted at in those verses. The good news is the coming of the kingdom of God. The coming of the kingdom of God. And that's the same message the disciples would go and share, that this coming of the kingdom of God. The disciples weren't telling people about the cross early on. The disciples didn't know about the cross. I mean, later on, Peter would even argue with Jesus about it. When Jesus said, "Who am I?" Peter would say, "You're the Messiah." And then Jesus talks about the cross, and he would say, "Never." And Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan." And so the disciples are sharing the same good news that Jesus is sharing, the coming of the kingdom. In Luke chapter 10, Jesus sends out 72 disciples, and they would take the message, "The kingdom of God has come near to you." In Luke 12, Jesus sends out the 12 disciples, and they proclaim the kingdom of God. See, the good news is the coming of the kingdom of God. The good news is that Jesus has come. The kingdom of God is where Jesus rules as king. The kingdom of God is where people are doing the will of God, where they're walking in the steps of Jesus. And so Jesus, as he goes out and says the good news, he's not talking originally in the beginning about the cross. He's talking about a kingdom. He's talking about himself. Coming as the king. The good news is that Jesus, the king, has arrived. The good news is that Jesus, the king, has come. Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, has arrived. He's arrived to usher in a new kingdom. He's not putting a temporary political structure in place. He's not putting a new empire in place. He's bringing in the eternal kingdom. The kingdom where he reigns as Lord and Savior, the King of Kings. The good news is that the kingdom has come. And when the kingdom comes, the kingdom also brings the cross, brings Easter, and brings salvation. That's what people were celebrating on Palm Sunday. They were celebrating, even though some didn't fully understand it, they were celebrating the coming of a king. Kings would come into town, and they would usually come on a majestic big horse with soldiers and a parade. And Jesus comes on a donkey, meek. See, your king comes to you gentle and riding on a donkey. In John chapter 12, we read some of the other responses of the people. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." In Luke 19, the Lord, Jesus is King. But what kind of King is he? What kind of King is this that comes?
Now we have a king. We have King Charles, right? And it was a big moment. Queen Elizabeth, who had reigned for a long time, and finally King Charles becomes king. And so we pray for him as king. He's officially the head of our country. We pray for him. But if I'm honest, King Charles doesn't have too much power. If I was somehow able to upset him, if somehow I came across him and I offended him, I wouldn't really fear for my life. Not that I'm planning to offend him, but I wouldn't fear for my life. If the king somehow came along and he decided that he wanted me to do something, and he ordered me to do something, or he ordered me to move, maybe. But I don't have to, right? We have our modern kings have prestige, they have influence, but they don't have power. Now, in the ancient Near East, in the time that Jesus was walking on the earth, kings had so much more power. Caesar could tell people to get up, leave where they are, go to the home of their ancestors for tax purposes. We've all been filing our taxes over the last month or so, or we should be, and I file my taxes, it gives me knots in my stomach. I mean, it's always a good answer, but it still gives me knots in my stomach. But I still don't have to travel to the home of my ancestors to do it. Caesar, he tells Joseph and Mary that they need to travel to the home of their ancestors. They don't argue, they go. And so the kings of the ancient Near East, they had more power. And you read through the Old Testament, you read about Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, Cyrus, the king of Persia. They made decrees and things happened. They had power. Now, what if someone was not only a king with that kind of power, but was also God? What if they were also God? That's who Jesus is. Jesus is God, but he is King of kings and Lord of lords. He is a king with power unlike any other. Many years ago, when I was in youth group, a quick question. I think my lapel mic is dead, right? It is dead. All right. I'm trying to keep here, but I'll behave myself and not move. All right. Many years ago, when I was in youth group, more years than I'd like to say, we went on a youth retreat. It was a great retreat. We lived up in Mississauga, and we went down to the magical land of Niagara Falls. And we had a retreat there, hung out at Clifton Hill. It was a lot of fun. That Sunday we got back, after the service, my mom comes up to me, and she says, "I hear you responded to an altar call." No. No, I didn't. "Yeah, the youth leader said you responded to an altar call." No. No, I'm already a Christian. I didn't respond to an altar call. No. The youth leader said that there was an altar call and you stood up. Oh, yeah. Okay. I may have been daydreaming. And what happened was I heard the speaker say, "If Jesus is your king, if you are willing to do whatever he tells you to do, if you are willing to go wherever he tells you to go, if he is not just your savior, but he is Lord of your life, stand up." And I stood up. And I couldn't figure out why no one else was standing. I thought we were all going to stand up. I thought, isn't that what being a Christian is? Isn't that what being a Christian is? That he is my savior and my Lord. That wherever he tells me to go, whatever he tells me to do, I do it. The people in Jerusalem, they demonstrated that Jesus was their king. And it's interesting for us, I think sometimes the idea of Jesus as king in our lives, this idea that Jesus is a modern king kind of starts to creep in. That Jesus is nice, that he's a figurehead, that what he says for us to do is a suggestion. We sing about Jesus being king, but we're still the ones calling the shots. We sing about him being Lord, but we're still the ones with the higher authority. It creeps in. We read something in scripture, or we feel convicted, and we feel that God is telling us to do something. Jesus tells us to do something, and we say, thank you for the suggestion. I'll think about it. I'll pray about it. Is Jesus your Savior and your King? The people in Jerusalem, they welcomed him as King. They demonstrated that he was the King, right? They took palm branches and they shouted, Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. Or in the Gospel of Luke, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. It would have been really amazing to be there. So often I read scripture and I think, how amazing would it be there to be in the crowd? To be in the crowd, even though I don't understand all that's going on, the language they're speaking, just to be in the crowd and to see Jesus come in on the donkey, to be in the crowd and see people laying their cloaks and the branches in front, to hear them shouting out praise to Christ, that would be amazing. I mean, what would you give to have been there that day? To celebrate Jesus as King. Jesus is the King who walked on water, who proclaimed the good news to the poor, freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. The King who said, if no one will worship him, even the rocks will cry out to praise him. Jesus is King. Is Jesus your King? I wrote two endings to the end of this sermon. And we don't usually do this, but I'm going to go with the alternate ending to the sermon. Sometimes there's value in making a declaration, saying, this is what I believe. This is what is important. This is what I'm willing to stand for. And you don't want to daydream through this part like I did so many years ago. So this morning, I'm going to give everyone here an opportunity to respond, an opportunity to declare that Jesus is more than Savior, he is your King. And I know not everyone is at the same point in their journey. We're all on a journey walking in the steps of Jesus. For some of us, you know, you're exploring who Jesus is. You're curious, you're learning. For others, you've accepted him as a Savior. And for others, you've accepted him as King as you walk along. And so this morning, I don't expect everyone to respond, but I wanted to give each of us an opportunity to respond, to make a declaration, much like they did on Palm Sunday 2,000 years ago. So if you are here this morning, and Jesus is your King, if you are willing to do whatever he says, to go wherever he tells you to go, whether you made that declaration long ago, a few years ago, or just this morning, I want you to stand with me. Is Jesus your King? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, King of kings, Lord of lords, oh Lord, we thank you. We thank you, we praise you. Oh Lord, how it must have been amazing to be there 2,000 years ago and to declare your King. Lord, how amazing is it to be here this morning and declare that you are King. And Lord, we look forward to the day we stand in heaven before you with the multitudes that know you as Savior and King. And we sing 1,000 hallelujahs. We praise you and we give you 1,000 hallelujahs. Lord, we declare you our King and Lord. We give you all the praise, both now and forevermore. Amen. Please stand as we sing together.
Thousand hallelujahs, a thousand.
I'm looking forward to this coming week. I'm looking forward to being able to celebrate Good Friday together, to celebrate Easter together. What an honor and a privilege it is to come together, brothers and sisters in Christ, to celebrate our King. A King who comes humble on a donkey, who comes and dies for us. And to celebrate then his defeat over death, to celebrate his resurrection and the hope that we have in him. I am looking forward to Good Friday and Easter Sunday, and I'm hoping you will join me and bring other people. I was talking with Norm earlier this week. He was talking about one of his friends who says, I can't come to church, I work. And I said, not on Easter Sunday, he doesn't. So if you ask someone and they say they're working, they're lying. Bring them. Nothing is open unless they're first responders. Then let them do their job. But invite them out. It would be great. It'd be great to have them. What is bigger than someone rising from the dead and forgiving them of their sins and giving them the hope, a hope for eternity, a hope for today and tomorrow? So invite them out as well. If you have not been baptized and you've been a Christian for more than 2 minutes, next week we would love to have a baptism as part of the service. If you have children and over the years you've not done a child dedication, come talk to me. We would love to set that up. There are so many practical ways to demonstrate Jesus as King. There's so many practical ways, day in and day out, to acknowledge him as King. And the most amazing thing is this is not an impersonal King. This is not a King that doesn't care about you, that is wanting to exploit and use you. This is a King that loves you more than you can imagine. A King that loves you more than you can imagine. So go this week knowing how great God's love is for you.